gaming sector is worth more than the film and music industries combined. With more than 500 million people streaming esports content in the last 12 months alone. The phenomenon of esports is broadcast via traditional media platforms and played in front of live studio audiences. Recently, the coronavirus pandemic shone a mainstream light on a highly valuable market already seeing significant investment from big-name brands. We sent reporter Ross Kelsall to dig a little deeper into this world, focusing primarily on sim racing, where the crossover between traditional sports and esports is as close as it gets. Formula One stars like Lando Norris and Max Verstappen have grown up using car simulators in their homes to compete against people online all over the world. Ross has been speaking to some of the biggest names in esports today, including England footballer Jesse Lingard and ex-Formula One driver Romain Grosjean, who have both set up their own teams. First up, Ross headed to Red Bull Racing HQ, where team principal Christian Horner explained why the F1 supercar moved into the sim world, racing in competitions like the V10 R-League.
Well, we saw esports, you know, growing and growing and growing, and you know, the virtual world of racing. You know, Max in particular was, you know, somebody that absolutely highlighted it to us.
The pandemic really put a spotlight on it. And how has that developed for you guys? How have you seen that growth?
Well, you know, obviously being sat at home, you know, and the youth of today are so engaged in the virtual world. I found myself sitting watching, you know, eSport Grand Prix and the Formula One, you know, championship, and our race drivers, or certainly Alex Albon, getting involved in that last year. So, and you find yourself, even though they're virtual cars, getting involved, because the racing is great. Yeah. You know, it's exciting, it's close-quartered, and yeah, it's really very engaging, even as a spectator.
Is there a lot of crossover between the esports and the F1 worlds within Red Bull Racing?
Well, it's becoming ever closer and closer, because of course we do a lot of our development in the virtual world. We have three you know, full simulators here that the race drivers and test drivers are working in. And so the graphics, the feeling, the cues that they get, that virtual environment is becoming closer and closer and closer to what you know, our esport racers are experiencing.
So did the F1 drivers, did they really feel the benefit of working in the simulators then?
You know, our test drivers are constantly, you know, working on that behind the scenes. We have, you know, Sergio Perez driving it today. Max will be in tomorrow. And you know, it's very much a day's testing, you know, in the virtual world.
Have you ever had a go yourself?
I have, and it's surprisingly scary, even though you can't theoretically hurt yourself, it still feels incredibly fast. And what amazes me is the quality of the graphics, the fidelity and the feel. You feel every bump, every curb, every change of surface. And it's quite remarkable, the reality that is now achieved.
And what do you see as the future, both for Red Bull Racing and esports? Do you think this area will just continue to grow?
I think it's just going to continue to grow and grow and grow. We're seeing more and more interest. We're seeing more and more partners coming in. Of course, the two will merge at some point, as we'll take, you know, a gamer and put them in a real car. And that's already, you know, starting to happen. And of course, Max is a very keen, you know, esport racer. He's been successful in esports. Yeah. And he drives with all the same, you know, determination that he does in the real world. So it's a generational thing that we're starting to see come through now, and it's exciting to see, because it feels like we're only at the start of that journey.
I know there's lots of sponsors involved in Formula One and esports. Am I right in thinking you've got sponsors that cross both and want to be involved with both your F1 team and the esports side?
We've got some that cross both, and then we have sponsors that are unique just to esports. They just want to be in that area. And so it's a growing portfolio of partners that we have as the viewership and the following, you know, grows and grows. So it's, you know, commercially it's interesting, and it's still a race, it's still a competition.
And your e-arena is based here on site, isn't it? It's all part of the same family.
Very much so. The e-arena we created, you know, last year, it's a great space. It's a gamer's dream.
Having seen viewing figures for F1 esports surpass their real-life counterpart for the first time in 2020, it's clear to see why Red Bull created a dedicated e-arena at the heart of their operation. Ross headed there to speak to one of the team's sim drivers, Graham Carroll, who has a real-world racing background.
Yeah, I used to do a bit of sort of Formula Ford and karting back in the day, but just run out of budget. But yeah, Scottish Formula Ford champion, the sort of British Formula Ford, the Walter Hayes trophy. But yeah, just
quite a trophy collection at home.
Yeah, they're all sort of in the hut now, out the way, but it's, I do miss it, but this esports stuff, it's as close to as real life as you'll ever get, you know? Level to be the best that you're, the best at the world at these different sort of games, it's a hard job, you know? So the level of competition is what really draws me to it, you know?
And when did you make that transition into full-time sim racing?
I won the British Formula Ford Championship in 2008, tried for 2 years to get sponsorship, and then probably picked up sort of sim racing, but that was just casually playing with a controller at points to start with. And nothing really serious, not trying to make money off of it, just seeing a leaderboard there and just trying to top it. And then one day I seen a YouTube video of sort of iRacing and like loads of cars at once, and here we are. Yeah, I was just hooked to it ever since, and never turned back, you know, never turned back.
And you were just saying off camera, it's allowed you to move out of your folks' place, you're getting your first house all set up.
Yep, yeah, and that, like, again, like 5-6 years ago, I'd never believe I'd make it a full-time job.
Yeah.
And yeah, allowed me to sort of go and buy my own place, and it's going to be a sim race in heaven in there, I'll tell you. But nah, looking forward to it, and it's been awesome to have an opportunity to work for Red Bull, you know.
And what about the F1 drivers? Do you have much contact with them, passing them tips?
They jump on for a bit of fun, and whenever they do, they ask us for how to go faster, so we're always willing to help.
And who's quicker in the simulators, you guys?
We normally show them how it's done, but again, they're the best in the world, these guys, you know, so it doesn't take them long to adapt, it really doesn't.
Obviously, media duties are really important for Formula One. Is that something you have to do more of in esports as well?
It's definitely getting more. We also have our communications managers that deals with all our sort of interviews and stuff, so it's pretty professional in that sort of terms.
How do you find it? Are you happy chatting to people like me?
I do. I quite love chatting to anyone, you know. But I see some of the other guys, that's just not their cup of tea. You know, they want to go and sit in a rig in the corner and not speak to anyone. But I don't mind it, to be honest, it's fine.
As well as sitting down with the social media team, Graham underwent an intensive fitness class with Red Bull, placing the same level of expectations on their sim drivers as they do on their F1 stars. We thought we'd put Ross to the test to see just how difficult driving a simulator was, with Williams Racing agreeing to let him loose. But first, their head of esports, Stephen English, took Ross on a tour of their on-site Formula One museum.
Yeah, you really get a sense of the heritage of Williams and what it means to both motorsport and F1 more specifically when you see all the cars laid out like this.
It's a nice reminder to come down here. You know, you work here every day and you live what the team is today and what we do. And it's nice to come down here and be reminded that over the 40 years of history and the champions that have gone by, that we're all part of this legacy of Williams. It's really cool.
This one doesn't look quite so much like an F1 car. What have we got here?
So this is an electric supercar prototype that we developed for Jaguar. And it actually appeared in the Bond film Spectre. James Bond gets chased by a fleet of these around the streets of Rome. So, yeah, we're into lots of cool projects beyond just Formula One these days.
And I suppose esports probably falls into the same category, does it?
Yeah, it's an extension of that. You know, it's an innovative technology. It's new. It's somewhere where we're involved and fully committed to trying things beyond just the core sport of Formula One.
Oh, wow. So this is the heart of Williams Esports, is it?
Yep, this is the dedicated esports lounge that we've just built up here.
I can see plenty of nods to Formula One over there, lots of trophies won and helmets.
Yeah, so you've got some of the best moments from our decades in Formula One, some of the trophies and championships won, the helmets of some of our most iconic drivers, and then moving into our growing trophy collection from esports as well.
So these look like they could be good fun. Is there any chance I could have a go and see if I've got any natural talent and I've missed out all these years?
Absolutely, let's put you to the test.
After a quick lesson, Ross pulled out of the pits at Silverstone and quickly realised the skill level required to even drive on a simulator, let alone compete at the pinnacle of the sport. Leaving the Silverstone gravel and grass behind, Ross headed to another famous British track, Donington Park, to meet Team Redline founder Dom Doohan. Having set up more than 20 years ago purely as a sim racing team, Dom is uniquely placed to enlighten us on the history of sim racing and how the industry was first formed.
I learned that there was online racing. You could race 20 years ago, you could race against other people on the internet. And it had Toca 2 championships, and I got involved with that. I amazingly started winning things and cash back then. And I thought, you know what? It's time to kind of work out how to do collaborative setups together and work out how to do things together. And I just introduced a couple of the big names at that time to come and join me. And I was a relatively big name in the space as well. And that was the absolute foundation.
And you said you were racing for cash. What sort of figures were we talking about
back
then?
Huge, man. I mean, I could have retired then. It's like 50 quid. It was amazing. No, that was a lot back then. 50 quid, which, you know, at that time for doing a 20-minute race was quite good.
I'm sure we could talk for hours about how that journey's progressed, but can you just give me a bit of an overview of how we've got from that stage to almost where we are today and the enormity of sim racing now?
There were some key moments, and I'd say one of them was certainly what Formula E did in Las Vegas in 2017. They really put the stakes up there with having $1 million prize pool. And Bono House, one of the drivers, he now drives with Mercedes as well. He won it at that time and won $250,000.
For one race.
We've clearly come a long way from the days of Dom racing for £50, and he told Ross how the financial side of sim racing has exploded in recent years.
I mean, it's great for us because prize pools have really gone up over the last few years. And on the back of that, yeah, the sponsorship has grown massively. And we're starting to see the kind of FMCG brands get involved. They want to broaden their audience. They might not necessarily go into motorsport anymore. Yeah. They want to get into esports.
Max Verstappen, one of the leading lights in Formula One, is also involved in Redline. Can you just elaborate a little bit on his relationship with the team?
Yeah, Max is a huge driver in the team. Max just brings that mindset that you absolutely need as a, you know, world championship contender in Formula One. He brings that sim racing. And he loves sim racing, don't get me wrong. He's a huge sim racing fan. He understands, he watches loads of the streams. He understands who is where in the pecking order. He has his own sim racing rivals. Yeah, he is a sim racer who does Formula One, ultimately. Not a Formula One driver that does sim racing. Yeah, and that's how I see it.
And as a man who's been in the industry for 20 years already, how do you see the next 20 years? What would be your prediction for what's next for sim racing?
I mean, the first 20 has been stressful enough. it's a really good point, actually. I mean, I do think that the crossover between real and sim racing, where the real drivers are doing sim racing for real points in the championship.
Yeah.
And I can see down the line that the sim and real will really merge and that you'll have sim drivers actually and pro drivers racing in sims for real championship points. I don't think it will be a gimmick. At the moment, it might be seen as that, but I think it will go towards that way.
A new entrant into the space are Veloce, who were established in 2018 and have more than 60 gamers on their books, seeing north of 200 million views each month to their content. The company's co-founder, Jack Clark, explained how sim racing can be used to scout talent that have yet to be afforded the opportunity to showcase their abilities on track.
It's an access point for millions and millions, and in the future, billions of people to get involved in elite competition sport from their bedrooms, you know? And I think that is a good thing, you know? Certainly motorsport, I think it really kind of opens up the pool of talent. And we've found some amazing performers, you know, some of the most elite.
Yeah, I was going to ask that. Have you seen incredible them coming through to possibly go into real-world racing or comparable levels?
Yeah, I mean, we see James Baldwin at McLaren, you know, he's driven on track in the real world and he's really kind of held his own and is a fantastic driver in both the real world and the virtual world. So I think it's a great case study for that.
And looking at your staff today, people I've spoken to, all relatively young as well. Mm-hmm. Do you think there's a correlation between sort of the age profile of the staff in gaming and those watching it?
During the pandemic, you know, we launched a series that was, at the time, due to circumstances, was the biggest sports event in the world at that particular moment. You know, it was trending on Twitch and YouTube, and
what was that?
It was not the GP series. So we had, it was more of an entertainment series. We had Charles Leclerc, you know, other Formula One drivers, Lando Norris. We had the Real Madrid goalkeeper. We had Ian Poulter. that sports event that was covered, you know, it was published and recognized globally. It was run by one 19-year-old, you know? So, like I say, there are so many, you know, native digital consumers here that you will just see the breadth and, like I say again, democratization of this really sort of turbo-fuel the industry in general.
McLaren's shadow driver, James Baldwin, has seen his simulator successes translated into real-world opportunities. Ross visited James's home to hear more about that journey and understand what his title of the world's fastest gamer meant.
They invited 10 people to come and compete, and the idea was the 10 best sim racers around the world. So the Forza champion, the F1 esports champion, that, you know, and they took us to America, all expenses paid for, an awesome 2-week trip. So even if, you know, didn't win it, it was pretty cool. Driving real cars, simulators, physical tests, all that stuff. And the idea from their point of view was to find the best racing driver from that. And I fortunately won it and did a season of British GT in 2020. So pretty mad, really.
How did that go for you?
Really well. Won the first race, 3 poles, a few podiums, 4th in the championship. Should have won it, but it's just one of those things. Luck wasn't on our side at certain points. But
James is a trailblazer for sim racers looking to break into the expensive world of elite motorsport and shows us his home setup.
2017, I just got a very casual gaming setup, so a cheap wheel, a rig, just do a bit of fun, try and fill the void of competition and driving. And the sims back then were still pretty good, so I thought, it's a bit fun. Did a competition, won a little bit of money from it, and then saw it as a potential short-term career path.
Okay.
And it just kind of escalated from there, really. 2018, won a few more competitions, joined Veloce Esports. 2019 was like an insane year of winning like 4 or 5 different comps, was fastest gamer being one of them. And 2020 was, yeah, I mean, that helmet kind of symbolises 2020 from the real-life stuff in GT.
Oh, yeah, Jensen. So that's working with Jensen Button or Jensen Button's team?
Yeah, driving for him, yeah.
And that must be pretty surreal.
Yeah, I mean, he did one of the rounds as well, so we were in the same garage, comparing data, just chatting with him. I mean, he commented on my Instagram post yesterday. It was bizarre, but really? It's just like, yeah, it's been a mad for years, definitely. Esports is it's a growing industry. There's definitely an option there to make it a career, and that's what I'm trying to do now.
And is your dream still to move into real racing, or do you think you'll always like this, the combination?
Definitely one day. I mean, I think my esports team probably don't want to hear that, but, you know, that kid who wanted to be a racing driver, he's not just disappeared because he's done one season of racing. I want to do it again and again and again. And I think I could do a good job, but it's not down to that. It's down to the finances and the opportunities and just, like, timing.
In real life racing, are there more and more people like yourself who've either done some, then done a bit of sim and moved in? Like, do you think that sort of those worlds are a bit more interconnected than they were in the past?
There is a space for that. I think it's a unique point in the esports, you know, that the fact that the esports side is so realistic and close to reality, it's kind of unique. Whereas, you know, Call of Duty, for example, is nothing like going to war.
So are there quite a lot of skills that you feel like you hone here that you can use on track and vice versa, like a setup maybe coming from that back to the sim?
Yeah, I mean, that's why it went so well last year, was because I learned so much on the sim over the last 4 years.
The level of detail that the sims have in terms of tire degradation, the way you set them up, like, has that grown in the last few years, or has that always been in the simulator abilities?
Yeah, they definitely get more realistic in every way. It's 95% of the way there. In terms of the way you prepare a quali lap, the physics of the car, like it's very similar. I've got virtual reality down there, the headset, and that helped me a lot before I got to the weekend. So I'd go to the weekend, set Snetterton, Friday morning, go for practice, and I'd feel like I've already been here before from the game. So it's very helpful.
That's a crazy level of detail, isn't it?
It's insane. It's mad. Like even in the car, you look around in the game, and you can see switches and stuff all in the same position as they are in the car. And it would help my memory when I got to the weekend.
Yeah, you got like muscle memory.
Some of the mechanics, you know, would say, how did you remember like stuff like that? It's from the game. So it's an advantage. So I think if you're a driver coming up through the ranks, you'd be silly not to, really.
Plus, you're exposed to the audiences of esports, which are a lot bigger than the ones in real-world motorsport, to be honest.
James highlighted the crossover between sim and real racing, something that is not always the case in other esports. Football title FIFA is one of the most played games globally, with Ryan Pessoa realising the level of his ability while playing casually at university. Ryan shot to prominence at the 2017 Virtual FIFA World Cup, and the Red Bull athlete represents Premier League champions Manchester City.
The World Cup was when it just sort of clicked, where there was a lot of infrastructure, a lot of teams that were there, like professional football teams. You had Man City, you had PSG, you had all of these massive, massive teams in the industry. And it made me think, all right, this could be a potential avenue as a career choice. And yeah, here I am today.
Okay, so what was the prize pool then? How much was that one for that World Cup?
If you won it, you won $200,000. And if you came second, it was, I want to say, $75,000.
Okay, so big.
Yeah, yeah. So that was huge. And since then, it's been going on leaps and bounds as well.
So that World Cup, obviously, very big moment.
Yeah.
Can you take me back to it? Talk me through the emotions, what it's like playing in front of that crowd?
Yeah. Initially, I just remember the first thing that comes to mind is playing, and then you have like a camera crew around you, you've got all the lights, you're on like a stage and everyone's watching you play, compared to where I'm usually playing. I'm just at home, just in my bedroom, just playing by myself. So that was sort of a massive, I would say, shock and realization that this is a big thing. It's being broadcasted online. A lot of people are watching. And again, as I say, it was nerve-wracking. I never forget the moment. But again, I love it. I've learned from it as well. And I guess the experience has made me a lot better as well.
And is there any crossover between the players,
like
the professional players at the club and the FIFA players?
I played against Aguero, of course, not currently a City player, but still a legend of Manchester City. Yeah, massive, massive player in the league. And played against a few other pros as well. Played against Trent Alexander-Arnold, the Red Bull as well. And I'd probably say Trent's better than Aguero, actually. Trent's very competitive. You can tell, like, he's part of that Liverpool team. They're used to winning every game.
Sergio Aguero and Trent Alexander-Arnold aren't the only professional footballers that enjoy gaming, with the likes of David Beckham also moving into this space. England international Jesse Lingard has set up an esports team under his J Lings brand, and Ross went to a gaming bar in Manchester to speak to the lifelong gamer.
You know, in my free time, I tend to play with my friends and other footballers as well. So, you know, it can get that team bonding a little bit.
Yeah. Which other footballers you playing with? Anyone with now?
I play with Marcus a little bit. Pogs, Sancho. Luke Shaw's very good. Yeah, he's very good at a lot of games, but he doesn't tend to play with us at the moment. but he's quite, like I said, he's quite a few, and obviously my friends as well at home.
What made you want to go from it being a hobby to sort of a professional element for it?
There's millions, you know, who are on the stream, millions who play, you know, games, and obviously there's, you know, esports teams out there, which a lot of footballers have taken over at the moment, and I thought it was a perfect time as I've, you know, gradually played, you know, all my life, and being a gamer is a perfect opportunity. I think there's a, you know, massive crossover, but, you know, all connects and, you know, it's kind of similar. So where I can give advice to them, you know, I will, and they can give me advice as well.
Yeah, you're getting tips off them so you can take them back into the United training ground and start beating everybody.
Yeah. I've obviously spoken to my captain, Sam, a couple of times. You know, he's my captain at the moment. He's one of the best, you know, out there at the moment. So, you know, we're communicating on, and yeah.
Nice, I like that, getting the inside info. What sort of support network do they have?
Diet requirements, nutrition, it's important as well. You know, it's key concentration level. So, like I say, I think football and esports fit hand in hand.
So we recently had the first FIFA player move for a transfer fee, which is obviously very big news in the esports world. Obviously, it's very common for players to move in the football world. Do you think we're going to see more and more of that?
Yeah, I definitely think we could. I think the business that we're in at the moment, you know, if someone wants to get bought, you know, why not? And especially with me and my team, you know, we're going to obviously start making it, you know, for them into an athlete brand, you know, have their own streams and obviously get them sponsored as well. So, you know, it can be huge for them. It can be, you know, huge for my team and huge for them individually.
And what about the future then for sort of this area? Obviously, you've said you think it's going to grow. Is there anything you can predict? What do you see the development like?
You know, why not, you know, have, you know, esports in stadiums maybe, possibly. That could be a big possibility. Like I say, the space, like I said, at the moment, is only going to grow, and, you know, millions more are going to are going to join, but I like to see it in stadiums. That'll be a massive plus.
Nice. Very good. Very good.
Let's get on GoldenEye.
Both Ryan and Jesse grew up gaming on consoles, and that also can be the case for elite-level sim racers. Sean Arnold was a leading light on Forza, and through his dedication, found that he was able to compete against those with real-life racing backgrounds in the virtual world.
I don't know if this is going to be correct, but I think there was like 96 tracks, and I had 92 number ones.
Wow.
Yeah.
So what were you doing for work at that time?
Painting and decorator.
So was there a moment where you thought, OK, I'm not just good at this as a hobby, this could be something I could do full-time?
This Le Mans eSports series started up and you'd get money from every round. So say there was six rounds to the final. If you won the rounds, you'd get £1,200. Or was it dollars or euros?
Yeah.
So I think I won like four out of the six rounds and come second and third in the other two. So I was like, I've just made like £7,000. Yeah, I haven't even got to the final yet.
Yeah.
So I was like, I think I could make a living off this if it keeps up like that. So yeah.
Sean's rise to the elite level was different to many of his contemporaries. So Ross asks the Fordzilla driver if he believes esports is a way to democratise motorsport.
It's accessible to everyone, and that's the great thing about sim racing is that you can always compete, and you can still, for a reasonable budget, get into sim racing and still be able to compete and, you know, enjoy it and be at the top even.
And what about the financial side of it? Are you salaried by Fordzilla? Does your salary depend on how well you perform? How does that work?
Yeah, well, Fordzilla obviously pay me a salary as an elite driver, which is great. And Ford, I can't stress enough how much they, you know, are generous to me and helpful.
And you've obviously mentioned you've pre-pandemic, you've competed in, I think it was LA, Seattle. You said Fordzilla, their first event was in Cologne. What's that like, sort of globe-trotting? That must be pretty cool.
Yeah, it's really good, yeah. Getting a chance to come from a little village in Wales, and then that's the first time I ever went on a plane, was to go to Seattle.
Really?
Believe it or not, yeah. So I travelled like
long
12
first
hours.
First flight, yeah.
I know, I was looking forward to it until I got like 6 hours in, and I was like, another 6 hours to go, no way.
There's only so many films you can watch.
Exactly. But obviously getting the chance to travel the world, going to Seattle, places like Seattle and LA, you dream of that as a child, not even just as competing in something, you know. You got there, you know, by merit, and you know, you actually achieved something. You know, I'm getting flown across the world. Yeah, I have a beautiful partner and children as well, so it's hard sometimes.
Of course,
going
miss
and,
them.
Being away from them.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you know, who does not want to go traveling the world? You know, we live on this planet, and you get to go and travel to see places you would never normally go to see, you know?
Yeah. Do you think the pandemic has helped, well, either your career or sim racing more broadly?
I think it's definitely helped sim racing. Put a spotlight on it, I think it needed, especially when you'd see the real drivers coming from other, you know, forms of motorsport, if it's, you know, F1 or GT racing, etc., yeah. IndyCar, and then seeing them doing it. And also them saying it's not as easy as people make it. It's quite, you know, even they are shocked sometimes of how much it's like the real thing, you know.
Yeah.
And obviously the exposure, I think it has helped, yeah.
Do you enjoy competing against the real racers and putting them in their place?
Yeah, of course I do. We raced Jenson Button in a 12-hour charity race. We beat him and we won the race, so I felt good. Overtaking Jenson Button, F1 world champion, you know.
Yeah, it doesn't happen too often, does it?
Button isn't the only former F1 star that's made the crossover into sim racing. A veteran of more than 170 Grand Prix, Romain Grosjean went one step further and set up his own esports team in early 2020. We couldn't make a documentary in these times without including a video call, so here's Ross chatting to the RHG founder.
Esports, sim racing, we do have similarities. We do have real racers coming and racing against the gamers. Sometimes I join a session on a server on a video game and people are like, oh, I'm racing against Romain Grosjean, I can beat him, you know?
Yeah.
And that is outstanding, because you get the chance to do that, whilst in real life, it's very complicated, you know? As I say, I think the viewing and the people are getting more and more interested about it. The graphics are getting better. We see some big championship getting into esports, the Formula E, Le Mans Virtual Race, V10, with some very professional approach, and therefore more that's going to go, more it's going to grow.
How easy or difficult has it been for you when you're setting up a team to attract sponsors and, you know, gain that revenue so you're not having to pay for the whole team yourself?
Really, it's been easy in a way. Obviously, you know, as some partner that follows me for some years now, and that has been important. Also, the Formula One season was a bit shortened, so for the partner, it was important to be seen on somewhere else and to have some good visibility. Yes. And as I say, you know, in terms of views, we're talking millions of views, and that is huge.
You see, the skills is very transferable from sim racing to real world racing.
Yeah, I do believe sim racing is a very good way to bring drivers to real life. You know, we've got now four drivers that are doing the step from sim racing to real racing, and they're actually very fast. We've got two guys in Formula 4 and one guy in the Brit Car Endurance Championship in the UK on Praga, Jordi Much, and he's been selected to race the full season. So for me, that's really the idea, is that we can use the experience from esports to bring it to real life. And whereas, you know, real life costs so much money at the beginning, if we can find talent through esports, that's something quite big.
Our journey has taken us from the pinnacle of traditional motorsport to those turning a hobby into a profession as the lines between virtual and real racing blur. Sim racing looks destined to continue growing as big name brands invest heavily in sponsorships and drive up prize pools.
It looks like he might as they enter the last corner. Ziggy goes defensive. They're going to be so close as they cross the line. But BMW are your champions.
Where esports may have once lived in the shadow of traditional sports, it has now grown into a full industry in its own right and is predicted to surpass revenues of $1.5 billion by 2023. Either in packed out arenas or via live streams, 700 million people are expected to watch esports content in the next 12 months. Will you be one of them?